The following program contains flashing images.
Grand Theft Auto is one of the most popular game franchises of all time. From its early roots in the late 90s, to the highest grossing piece of media ever created with Grand Theft Auto 5. However, today we're going to take another trip down memory lane and showcase a speedrunning history for a game I'm sure you all know from 2004. The highest selling game ever made. Speedrunning is extremely popular, and it has been one of the most popular games on speedrun.com for half a decade. Now what if I told you that speedruns of this game started only 8 months after this game's release, and that we can still see the footage to this day? Let's take a look. This footage that you're seeing is a VHS recording from June 2005, and shows Andy NTG Nelson completing San Andreas in 7 hours and 46 minutes in game time, segmented on the PlayStation 2. This run was archived via archive.org, and NTG's comments on the run are still able to be viewed. There's a lot of really interesting things to note here, including several theories that NTG had about strategies that he couldn't quite pull off, that we now do in regular runs in the modern day 15 years later. This run was very impressive for its time, so let's break it down a little bit. The first interesting theory that NTG had was launching the bike onto the train during wrong side of the tracks for a quick kill. A strategy that the current world record holder in the modern day has implemented into his runs. It's really crazy to me that theories NTG had would take over a decade to be properly implemented into runs. He also took some time during the photo opportunity segment to take a swim seemingly randomly, but this is actually a deliberate routing choice as you must level up your lung capacity via swimming for a mission later on in the run. Another strat was using the heat-seeking rockets to take down Torino during Torino's last flight. But NTG notes here that it must be possible to use the normal rocket launcher, but could never get it to work. In modern speedruns, we do indeed have a lineup to instantly blow up the helicopter using the normal rocket launcher. Nowadays, there's a ton of documented knowledge on the game's behavior and why certain things happen. However, back in 2005, this information simply did not exist. This is why it's extremely impressive that NTG wrote in his comments about Las Venturas, where he deliberately re-entered the helicopter he used for the segment in order to stop it from despawning. A mechanic we understand very well nowadays, as vehicles you use during missions will be cleaned up afterwards, and re-entering them prevents this. NTG shows another example of strats still used to this day from 15 years ago, during Vertical Bird, as he notes that if you fly low enough, the hydras chasing you will destroy themselves, then it's simply a matter of blowing up the boats as usual. As you can see by these notes from NTG, the run was still extremely primitive, but also had a number of exceptional theories and even strats still used to this very day. This run surely set the foundation for San Andreas speedrunning, and would set itself as the first piece in an extremely complex puzzle. The next piece we're going to take a look at is the returning special guest from my Vice City World Record progression, Daniel Cannibal K9 Burns.
Hi, I'm Daniel Burns, also known as Cannibal K9, and welcome to my speedrun of Grand Theft Auto San Andreas.
Daniel used the PC version for his runs, but they were still segmented due to the insanely long length of the run at the time. We still use the PC version to this day for many reasons, such as faster loading times, as well as mouse aiming. Well, most people do. There are numerous examples of Daniel also using the strategies found by the SDA, otherwise known as Speed Demos Archive community, that are still used to this day. A good example being the roof jump in Tagging Up Turf that skips the climbing tutorial. Daniel also uses strategies that are still not used to this day, due to the inconsistency in real-time runs. At the end of Tagging Up Turf, Daniel makes use of the broken bridge from the final mission to smash through it and take a shortcut back to Grove Street. This is the fastest way to complete the mission, but most runners nowadays don't go for it as it barely saves any time and you will usually flip the greenwood and be forced to reset. The Los Santos segment is a really complicated section due to all the different mission chains. This means that hundreds of routes are possible and you can end up going around the entire map if you're not careful. With this in mind, it's probably not a shock to hear that Daniel's route is very different compared to modern times, with him choosing to stay around Grove Street for as long as possible in order to unlock as many missions as possible later on without needing to backtrack. This is quite a sound theory, however the problem is that as he is saving and doing segments, he is manipulating the time in-game constantly, which means that different missions that are usually not available in real time now become available in segmented runs. Back to strat comparisons. Daniel makes use of a very well-known strat during the OG Loke mission, where you can actually shoot Freddy's bike yourself to kill him way earlier than intended, and skip the entire chase and shootout section. However, he notes that he doesn't recall who found this. Well, don't worry, Daniel, because after 12 years of searching, I can finally tell you this strat was done 3 years before you by none other than Andrew NTG himself in his PS2 run, albeit in a much, much slower way. A user by Snubs on the SDA forum details the much more efficient way, but the seed was planted, like with many other strats, way earlier than most people think. Daniel's use of the strat is what we know today, where you kill Freddy at the first opportunity, which is much faster. But this is more fascinating proof of strats being discovered and fine-tuned over years of research. Towards the end of Los Santos, there is a huge difference in routes and strategies in Daniel's run. The first being that he saved a ZR in the garage all the way back during Big Smoke and used that for this segment, where you have to drive across the entire map for Doberman and Grey Imports. This is obviously much faster than using any random traffic vehicle you'll find, but as we know nowadays, there's a much faster way to deal with this section by just using the fixed NRG motorbike spawn inside the multi-starry car park as soon as you finish Just Business. This bike is one of the fastest land vehicles in the game and allows you to run over the target during Grey Imports to kill him instantly. This insta-kill method was known to Daniel, as he uses it in Lost Sepulchros in order to kill Kane instantly, but at the time it wasn't thought about to use a bike for Grey Imports in a similar way. Here we also see another very notorious mission, Wrong Side of the Tracks. Daniel and the SDA community looked at many ways to speed up this mission and make it easier, and it was discovered in 2007 that you can jump on top of the train in order to kill the guys yourself, much like NTG theorized years prior. Daniel couldn't seem to pull this off consistently enough though, and by pure luck he found an entirely new strategy. This strategy involved killing the train driver, stopping the train in the process, and then simply climbing on top and killing the enemies. This is slower than the strategy NTG hinted at, that is still used to this day, but it was consistent enough for the time. During Against All Odds in the Badlands, NTG used a strategy with Bribe Stars in order to get rid of the wanted level without needing to go to the Pay and Spray. Daniel doesn't use this route, as he claims that simply using the Pay and Spray is faster. Daniel is right here, as NTG's route was quite slow in terms of execution, but the theory was there. It was later discovered that the Bribe Star idea is actually much faster, but simply with a more compact route that minimizes waiting time. Daniel does a very similar swimming route in order to upgrade his lung capacity for Amphibious Assault later on in the game, swimming back to San Fierro after photo opportunity. It does work out perfectly, as he gets a second upgrade for lung capacity right as he gets back to shore. Daniel shows that it's not necessary to follow the instructions during Mike Torino, and that you can instead just head straight to the airport where Mike is being held. Furthermore, on the way back, a Pay and Spray skip is once again utilized by grabbing some Bribe Stars to remove the 3-star wanted level. This route isn't the best, and would be improved on in the coming years to be much more efficient. Interestingly, Daniel mentions during Monster that he activated a cheat accidentally, but wasn't sure if he hallucinated it and it caused a reset.
Okay, I'm really bad at driving the monster truck. Actually, there's a funny story here. One time, I managed to activate a cheat. Completely accidentally. I was just driving along normally, tapping left, right, all over the place. And it activated a cheat, which put the day forward, the time forward a bit. Actually, that was the same one where I got my bike in the compound. So, I probably hallucinated it. Yeah.
This is a very rare occurrence that we now fully understand. More on that later. After Hijack, Daniel heads to the airport to get some homing rockets and a Maverick helicopter. What's interesting about this is that it was only around 2018 that helicopters were removed from the San Andreas route, as up until that point a Maverick was used in Les Venturas until it was discovered how much faster it is to just simply use replays and spawn extremely fast cars instead. Helicopters aren't a bad idea for these later stages, but as we now know, it is simply much faster to stick to the ground and use much quicker vehicles. Daniel obtains all gold medals during flight school, which is 100% on every single test, and notes that he does it for both the Hunter helicopter and the logic that a gold medal means you are being as fast as possible. This logic is simply untrue, as some tests require you to land in certain places for 100%, rather than just landing as soon as possible. This means that a lot of the time, you can get 70% and save time over 100%. Daniel knows that during Black Project, he tried numerous ways to jump all the way to the jetpack from the top of the huge staircase in order to skip all the fighting, but could not figure out a way to stop CJ from being killed. This is an interesting jump, as setups have been known for a long time, but they never seem extremely consistent, and each runner has different levels of consistency with them. As of 2020, even the current world record holder doesn't jump straight down from the top of the stairs due to how inconsistent it is.
I mean, what accent is that? I've got no idea. I'm sure I should know that as well, but I'm always terrible at accents. I have always been terrible at accents. I'm sorry, I'm a bit...
Just in case you ever watch this, Daniel, he's from Salford, which is in Manchester. Daniel notes during High Noon that he found a way to quickly kill Pulaski by hijacking his car, as apparently Pulaski's life force is connected to his car. That's Daniel's quote, not mine. While this is a super awesome strat, we know nowadays that you can kill any NPC this way, as holding sprint while you hijack a vehicle from the passenger side will kill the driver outright. Although Daniel didn't quite understand the strat, he did make good use of it here, and runners still make good use of it as well to this day. Daniel actually does the cutthroat business jump all the way across the river in order to trigger the cutscene using the BF injection. This strat is much faster than NTG's route, where he drives through Los Santos in order to cross the river. This jump is quite tricky even for today's standards, and a lot of modern runners still don't attempt it in runs. Daniel notes during Los Desperados that the homies you recruit are a complete liability, as they can get scared and dive out of the car, which loses around a minute. If you're familiar with current speedruns, you might have seen several great runs die due to the homies diving out. So it's interesting to hear about how these homies have been complete shit for over 12 years. With sending Tenpenny off the bridge, Daniel completes his own speedrun of San Andreas in around 6 hours and 10 minutes in-game time. This smashed NTG's run and put PC as the one true platform for San Andreas speedrunning from now on.
And we're almost there. So I'd like to thank Radix. He gave me lots and lots of help when I first started speedrunning, which has been quite irritating for him. So big thanks. Nate for all the technical stuff, which I really can't even begin to understand. And he sorted out my Spyro 3 run, which was very nice. And DJ Gnola for all the little finicky little bits. And I know how irritating those are, so doing so much of that is awesome. Jargon. Yeah, I say that all the time. Core. Blimey. Cheers. Tally-ho. Bollocks.
And thank you, Mr. Burns, for all you've done for GTA speedrunning. We now must jump forward several years, where speedruns were becoming more commonplace, this time done in single segments, meaning no timer pauses until the run is finished. In 2010, an SDA user by the name of DJS had done a single segment Los Santos speedrun with a time of 1 hour and 46 minutes, but recording was an issue for him, so no footage exists of these very early single segment runs. DJS had also done another run of doing both Los Santos and Badlands single segment, and it did have video, but it's unavailable due to copyright. Thanks, YouTube. The first video that exists from DJS is a video from October 2012 of him completing Up to the Jizzy mission in San Fierro in a single segment, taking just over 3 hours. However, the posts right underneath this video was made by a name you all surely recognize. Joshimus. Hey, you.
Me?
Yeah, you. Are you ready to find out what part Joshimus plays in San Andreas history?
I sure am.
Leave comments on his YouTube videos, hoping that he'll see them?
He never responds to me.
One day I'll get a response. One day. Joshimus responded to DJS and mentioned that he'd been planning on attempting to complete a full single segment run of San Andreas based on Daniel Burns' route. He also mentioned that he had completed single segment runs of Los Santos already, streamed to his Twitch channel. These city segment recordings no longer exist, but what does is a run Josh streamed in January 2013. This run is the first fully single-segment run of San Andreas in history.
Okay, I'm sure I'll be fine. Right, so as you can see, in load game, there is nothing in save file 4, and that's the save file I'm going to be using for this run, because when you press on load game, or when you press on save game, whatever, when you press on save game, your mouse is automatically on 4. So I can quickly save. which I'll be using throughout the run to sort out my times and whatnot, but yeah. For now, we're going to start a new game, and the second I press yes is when I'll start the timer. 3, 2, 1, go.
This run didn't have too many new strategies involved. In fact, in a lot of places it had less, simply because a lot of Daniel's strats weren't viable or sometimes even not possible in a single segment environment. For example, in Wrong Side of the Tracks, Josh did a much slower variant of the strategy and it is much more consistent. This run also bought a lot of time compared to Daniel's run, as Josh could not restart a segment until it was perfect, and playing for several hours perfectly is extremely difficult. Due to this, there are several mission fails and loss of key vehicles which lose him a lot of time further into the run.
Okay, so before I go into this marker, I'm going to pick up some more ammo. Someone's shooting at me. Sweet's dead. Oh, that's good. That's lovely. Excellent. Of course. Perfect. What else would I expect? No.
Keeping all this in mind, however, it was still very impressive, and a first of its kind. Josh sent Tenpenny flying in 7 hours and 48 minutes in a single segment.
The second, that's it. That's done. That's why the bridge is destructible there, yeah, for that scene. Obviously they couldn't program it properly, but... There we go. 7 hours, 48 minutes, and 20 seconds. Oh, that took really long.
It also wouldn't take long before Josh did a second run and beat his current best, as less than a month later, he would finish this run.
What can you do? This is the end, incidentally. So the seconds, that's it. 7:42. Still the 40s. Oh, I didn't even get 7:30 something. Jeez.
Josh wouldn't complete another run for a while, but there was good reason for this, as this next month was about to be one of the biggest in San Andreas history when considering the amount of awesome strategies that were found and how much time could potentially be saved. During this time, two users were on the SDA forums and brainstorming strats for Josh to use to lower his time even further. These two users were Nick66 and Patrick. Patrick is well known nowadays as a strat finder and code monkey in the GTA community, and was actually in the SDA thread as far back as 2011, giving ideas to Daniel Burns under a different name. During this time, a lot of strats were found. For example, Nick66 proposed a method of swimming during specific missions to get lung capacity while losing zero time, and avoiding the huge swim back halfway through San Fierro. Very soon after, Patrick proposed using a rifle to snipe the quad bikes on local liquor store in the ongoing 100% theorizing thread, skipping the chase entirely. He also proposed death warping around the Badlands in order to skip very long travel times and optimize the segment massively. This 100% thread was also theorizing grabbing a minigun from Torino's place after Vertical Bird, and using that to breeze through the final segments. This thread was regularly updated by Lots of S, who was also checking on the Any% thread to keep strats current on both sides. S helps finalize a Badlands route, using busted warps on top of death warps to make things much more optimal. By the end of the month, Patrick had also found a way to quickly kill Big Popper during a home in the hills with the minigun, skipping the chase entirely. He also used the minigun to get a quick kill on Pulaski during high noon. Around a week later, Patrick posted this video of him destroying all the boats on Vertical Bird instantly with the minigun instead of the Hydra. These strats were proof that the minigun was a vital component of strats at this time. Due to these strats needing the minigun, Patrick also proposed a different Las Venturas route that placed the airstrip missions in between the city missions, rather than doing them in a linear order. Around this time, Patrick posted a video of him getting a quick kill on Pulaski without the minigun, instead simply pushing his car and quickly hijacking him as he gets back on track. Furthermore, Lots of S had found a way to consistently skip the tutorial cutscenes in Rider right at the start of the game back in early March. He found that failing the mission first allowed you to skip the cutscenes as the game assumes you've already seen them. This strat included blowing up Ryder's car to fail the mission instantly and restarting it with the cutscenes now able to be skipped. Blowing up Ryder's car quickly became a common question in Josh's chat and eventually became a running meme. Hey, some extremely unfunny people still make the same 7-year-old joke to this day. The very next day, Joshimus posted a huge skip he had found, which skips the dancing section of the Life's a Beach mission. This skip is performed by grabbing a homie and manipulating him to get into the van, and then shooting him so he falls out and leaves the door open for you. This saves around 3 minutes compared to dancing, and is still done to this day. 4 days after Josh's discovery of Life's a Beach Skip, S made a post talking about how to skip the third wave on each gang territory. He mentioned that the territories are actually counted as taken or completed after round two, so you can simply start a side mission to skip wave three each time, skipping a third of all territory waves. Patrick then added to this stating that you can save even more time by chaining the third wave into the first wave of the next territory, making it even more optimal. Between February and March, Josh finished two more runs while implementing more and more of these strategies, and by March 17th he had smashed his prior times and came out the other side with a 6:39.04, which was a huge improvement. New routes, strats, and skips were being found every day, and it was clear that this game could go way, way lower. This run still had plenty of mistakes.
Oh shit. Fuck. Nope, nope. You've gotta be shitting me.
As I mentioned before, making silly mistakes is pretty much unavoidable in such a long run, and especially in a game as brutal as San Andreas. But this game had a lot of potential, and more people were joining the discussions over at the SDA forums. It was around this time that the discussion switched to whether the frame limiter in-game should be used or not. Until now, runners had just been toggling the limiter when it benefited them, as having unlimited FPS is faster or slower depending on the situation. The issue with unlimited FPS is that it made the need for a good PC to attain high frame rate more crucial to speedruns, and this would be unfair to runners who couldn't afford one. But at the same time, however, it was a game feature, and usually game features need a pretty solid reason to be banned. This discussion gains the attention of SDA moderators, as Josh was looking to have his records placed officially on the SDA page for all to see. Mikey Yama settled this debate by ruling that the frame limiter must stay enabled throughout the entire run to maintain fairness across all runs. This is still a rule to this day, although it's still highly controversial. In the middle of all the frame limiter debating, Bubble Bobbler posted a Twitch link of them using a glitch in San Andreas called sliding. This glitch is slower than sprinting, but faster than jogging, and in most interiors, sprinting is forbidden in San Andreas. This video no longer exists, but from the context of the thread, it seemed to be a video of Bubble using the sliding technique during reuniting the families to get through the level much more quickly than before. This would open doors for sliding to become used much more frequently in almost every interior. But sliding had actually been found and written about in this very same thread 6 years ago. It was simply glossed over because runners at the time didn't see a use for it as it was slower than sprinting. With Bubble's video, it was clear that sliding has a lot more use than originally thought, and more places would be found to slide soon after. Between April and July, the discussion went pretty quiet on the SDA thread, so we can switch back to checking up on Josh's progress for a bit. On April 12th, he did another run that just slightly edged out his PB by a minute, and this run was the first one where we could see Josh's concentrating face. This run was very solid to start with, but completely fell apart at the end, so Josh knew a low 6-hour time was on the cards very soon. On May 25th, he finished another run which was much more solid than the last all around. He managed to stay in the green, bar some mistakes later on, but the huge time save in A Home in the Hills made this an even bigger PB with a time of a 6:23.24.
3, 2, 1, 6:23.24. 7 minutes. 7 minutes. Well, no. More than 7 minutes. 14 minutes. I'm happy with that. It's another step closer to sub 6. Another step closer to step 6, and a new world record! There's that to get hype about.
It would be 2 months before Josh would beat his 6:23, but in the meantime, the SDA thread was gaining traction once more. During July, a new strat hunter emerged named Taduva, who posted a video on SDA detailing how to complete the Fender catch-up mission much faster. This mission requires you to scare a man to get information out of him by driving recklessly while he's tied to the hood of your vehicle. The old route involved driving around into oncoming traffic and slowly filling the meter up that way, but Taduva found that you can continuously pull handbrake turns to increment the meter much faster. For some odd reason, only left turns work. Weird game. Taduva also found a way to skip some shotgunner spawns during the You've Had Your Chips mission, making the fight in this mission much easier by shooting two of the objectives at the same time, which skips the trigger for the ambush to happen. Making difficult missions like this much more consistent was a big step in minimizing time losses in Josh's runs, as it was very easy to die in Las Venturas while trying to go as quick as possible.
That could have easily killed me if I was unlucky. Right, I do this to skip the whole, also there's a chainsaw here. Okay, whatever. I do that to skip all the... a load of extra guard spawn if you don't do stealth properly. And that counts as doing stealth properly, don't die. Run. Someone's still shooting me and I don't know where it is. Well, shit. GG.
On July 18th, Josh was scheduled to do a run at the European Speedster Assembly 2013, or ESA for short, at San Andreas. This run was broadcasted live from the location's venue, and is essentially a speedrun showcase rather than a world record attempt.
So yeah, I'm just waiting for her to tell us where the mission starts, and it's right here. Also, keep an eye on this window. Max Payne. Okay.
Tough crowd. However, this run so happened to be both at the same time, with Josh pushing Tempany over the bridge in a record time of 6 hours and 12 minutes.
Time.
That's
I need a damn shower.
Just so you know, Josh,
I'm so sweating.
On July 31st, a huge breakthrough was made. This wasn't a strategy, nor was it a big time save. What we got was an answer as to why sometimes specific missions were a ton harder than others, and why it wasn't purely luck-based. An SDA user named Random Machine, who had been doing some testing in a home in the hills, which was still a very problematic and risky mission at the time, found out that stealing a car before reaching the rooftop would cause him to die 100% of the time while sliding through, as the enemies were way more deadly. This was put into some further testing by Josh, and later was discovered to be the notorious accuracy bug that we all know today. To those that don't know what the accuracy bug is, I'll give you a quick rundown. In San Andreas, enemies are more accurate when you enter a car, as they need this boost in accuracy to account for the fact that you're moving much more quickly, so they're still able to attack you. This accuracy stat is supposed to be reset to normal when you exit the car, but it isn't. If you enter a car just before a gunfight, such as in a home in the hills, the enemies will be extremely accurate as though you are in a car, and you will be absolutely destroyed. If you do not enter the car, the enemies are way less accurate as normal, and you can consistently slide through without much trouble. As you can see in this video comparison made by Josh, he plays very sloppily and still makes it out alive in the second clip due to the AI being much less brutal. This glitch still exists and was never fixed, so if you've ever been playing the game, for example on the Steam version, and you've just been absolutely destroyed by AI, this is probably why.
You don't know who you're fucking with, do you? You trying to fuck with my house? With my shit? I'ma fuck with you!
On September 3rd, Josh finished a run to break his ESA record from a few weeks ago. This time he sent Tempany over the edge in 6 hours and 48 seconds. It seems that the video has been wiped by Twitch, so unfortunately I don't have any footage for you, but this run meant that the 6 hour mark would be broken very soon. How soon? 4 days later, but this time not by Joshimus, as San Andreas had some new runners on the block. This runner was called Cortec. Cortec wasn't the only runner who was competing with Josh back in 2013, but Cortec's first ever sub 6 on September 7th was a big improvement in terms of overall consistency for the time, as most of the time losses weren't Cortec's fault, but more so strange glitches in particular missions.
It's stuck.
it's fucking stuck. It's stuck! Take the bike. YOLO. That's all I have to say, just... Oh, there it is! Idiot, peace out, bitch. Fuck's sake!
However, as I mentioned, Cortec wasn't the only person looking for a sub-6 in San Andreas. A Korean runner known as Inspired had also been doing runs for a few months now, and even completed a run faster than Josh, but it wasn't legitimate due to the new frame-limiting rules. Inspired had also created some strats, such as using a sniper rifle to damage Dizzy's car on Ice Cold Killer, in order for him to be killed very quickly later on in the mission. A week after Cortec got the first sub-6, Inspired just scraped under the sub-550 barrier with a 549.59.
He's moving control! 6, 7, 8, 9. GG. Wow. Ah, GG.
Inspired's run lasted as the record all the way until November 6th, when a new runner would take the record from him and go on an almost 2-year-long spree of records all the way until late 2015. This runner's name was Omega. Omega was way ahead of his time in terms of skill. He held the world record for SA between November 2013 and November 2015, only losing it for a combined total of 3 weeks across that massive 2-year span. Omega started off his reign of terror with a 5:39 on November 6th, shaving 10 minutes off of Inspired's run.
GG! Man, about time. Oh man, chat is moving so fast.
Come on, assholes! I'll take you all! You're mine! Mine! I run this town!
This record would be the first time a record would stand for several months, as it lasted all the way until April 2014, when Taduva finally made his mark on the leaderboard himself with a 5:31. This 5-month span wasn't without its fair share of strats being found, though, as Random Machine was back looking for new innovations that runners could use. Earlier in the year, Inspired was optimizing the mission Stowaway, where you must blow up a plane from the inside out with a satchel charge and jump out before it blows up with you inside it. Random Machine discovered that you can simply shoot the plane and immediately jump out, which is slightly more difficult due to the strict timing, but much faster. He also made a big discovery in December 2013, detailing on the forum that you can flick your camera with the mouse in order to re-roll the traffic in front of you. This basically allowed speedrunners to keep re-rolling the traffic to avoid having to slow down for random traffic spawns, which saves a lot of time overall throughout the run. Just as we ticked into the beginning of 2014, Bubble found a method to complete the aforementioned Black Project jetpack jump, try saying that 3 times fast, consistently by holding down the escape key in order to do what we know today as pause buffering. Keep pause buffering in mind because we will be discussing that in a lot more detail later on. Furthermore, a huge time save in Snail Trail was discovered in February 2014. Usually during this mission, you have to follow a train all the way from San Fierro to Los Santos, and then follow a taxi all around the city until he reaches the pier. A random message from Hudson Smith during a streamed attempt theorized the idea of entering the train as it pulls into the station in San Fierro, which would then allow you to skip to the next station, skipping the entire train chase. This strategy worked and saved several minutes for free. On March 26th, 2014, a user by the name of Tuplanola, sorry if I fucked that up, posted a series of optimized route videos on the SDA forum. They had been fairly active in posting some updated routes throughout 2013, but right at the bottom of this particular post was a quote-unquote new strat in Wrong Side of the Tracks. The reason I emphasized the new there was because those of you with a good memory from earlier will remember that NTG himself theorized this idea way back in 2005, but noted it was too risky and difficult to pull off. It turns out NTG was right, because even with a better setup being found in 2014, very few runners attempted this, and it is still not commonly used to this day. Speaking of things being discovered way, way in the past, do you remember when Daniel Burns mentioned that he accidentally activated a cheat randomly way back in 2008?
Okay, I'm really bad at driving the monster truck. Actually, there's a funny story here. One time I managed to activate a cheat. Completely accidentally. I was just driving along normally, tapping left, right, all over the place. And it activated a cheat, which put the day forward, the time forward a bit. Actually, that was the same one where I got my bike in the compound. So, I probably hallucinated it. Yeah.
Well, the final remnants of the SDA thread in 2014 involved looking into why these cheats occur, as they were happening more and more frequently to runners at the time. Fortunately, Topwanola and the returning Nick66 had some answers for the community. Feel free to pause the video if you'd like a full technical explanation, because I will give a quick rundown for those similar to me who don't know shit about programming. Cheats in San Andreas are based on hashes, likely to be more efficient as SA was such a big game for its time. This, however, causes a big problem, as a single cheat can have many different codes that trigger them. For example, the wanted level cheat can be activated by typing AZACMY, IFIRSTDOS, or Tested Educational Skills. This means that there are many key combinations to activate cheat codes that the developers did not ever intend to be used. Most people know the health, armor, and money cheat as HISO YAM, but this is not actually the developer intended cheat, it's just a random hash. The intended one is I need some help. It also so happens that some of these combinations only involve the W, A, S, and D keys, meaning it's entirely possible to rarely activate a cheat while you're just driving around. Many cheats can be activated this way. For example, you can spawn vehicles such as a quad bike or the Hunter. You can even change the weather. While this discussion was taking place, Omega was trading the world records with both Taduva and S himself throughout April of 2014. On April 20th, Omega got a 5:30 flat, taking the record back from Taduva. S then took the record from Omega 9 days later with a 5:26. No video of this trade exists, but it's clear that these back and forth records were making great use of all the new strats found in the last month before Omega's reign continued all the way into 2015. And boy, let me tell you, 2015 was quite the year for San Andreas. As those of you who watched my Vice City world record progression will know, a user by the name of Bastant2 discovered an insane way to break GTA speedrunning wide open by abusing the replay system to dupe missions in 2014. This strat was also used in GTA 3 for the same result, but San Andreas didn't quite get the same privilege. The reason for this is that rampages were primarily used in the other games to dupe missions, but San Andreas only has rampages in the multiplayer modes on consoles. This meant that at the time there was no known way to dupe missions without external assistance. However, it was known that if duping was found, it could break the game even more than Vice City or 3 because of the way missions are chained together. I'll give you a quick summary. In San Andreas, missions are grouped into chains. For example, Ryder's missions in Los Santos, Home Invasion, Catalyst, and Robbing Uncle Sam, they're all part of a chain. For the sake of simplicity, we're going to call these missions 1, 2, and 3. In San Andreas, completing Mission 1 will unlock Mission 2, in the chain, as expected, and so on. However, the chains are just a counter of completed missions. So if you complete Mission 1 twice, somehow, then you will skip straight to Mission 3, which in this case would be Robbing Uncle Sam, after duping Home Invasion. This is because Mission 3 simply requires two missions in the chain to be added to the counter. This means that duping a mission would allow you to skip the mission afterwards, and as I'm sure you can imagine, skipping entire missions of the game can save an absurd amount of time. As I mentioned before, however, there was no known way to do this. The only thing close to this was when Vice City runner Tia was doing a San Andreas 100% run for fun and accidentally duped the quarry mission in late 2014. The way he did this was simply by parking the bulldozer next to the mission marker and having his phone ring as he started the mission. Cancelling a phone call places you back into free roam mode instead of mission mode, which then allowed Tia to start quarry a second time. Unfortunately, this wasn't a huge breakthrough, as quarry has a big delay when starting the mission, which gives enough time for the phone to ring, and this isn't possible to do in other places. However, Our main man Patrick was on the case and started an almost year-long hunt to find a setup for duping across the entirety of 2015. Omega had lowered the time all the way down to a 5:07 in November 2014, and this record would stand for a year while Patrick began his search. Patrick began by trying to start Quarry and other missions at the same time, and asked for help regarding it in the #GTA IRC channel. Runners at the time discovered that this would mostly result in a game crash and ended their search there, but Patrick simply wasn't satisfied. He would have multiple hour sessions of testing every possible mission scenario: quarry, valet parking, burglary, trucking, pimping, vigilante, anything he could get his hands on. This went on for months, until November of 2015, when Patrick made this video on his YouTube channel. Patrick's 9-month-long hunt was over. He had found a way to use the trucking mission and a phone call in order to dupe Ranfar Lee, which skipped Lur, the next woozy mission in the chain. Lur is a mission that requires you to take a rancher all the way into the countryside and is a very long and boring mission, but just like that, it was gone from the speedrun. Patrick also describes potentially duping Torino's last flight to skip the final San Fierro mission, as this mission is the one that checks if all of Woozy's missions have been completed. It is actually possible to skip the entire chain and go straight to the desert without ever completing a single Woozy mission. This unfortunately had a big drawback though, as San Andreas forces a 4-star wanted level on you if you go to another section of the game without unlocking it, and this skip would also skip unlocking the desert and Las Venturas. This means that runners would be forced to do the next 2 segments of the game while having 4 stars the entire time, which appeared impossible. It wasn't long before many dupe setups were found, including duping Hijack to skip Interdiction, Verdant Meadows to skip NOE, and Fish in a Barrel to skip Freefall. Within a week, Omega would begin doing attempts using this new Ranfar Lee dupe, and on November 13th he finished the first record with dupes with a 5:04:03. Now the game was getting very close to the sub-5-hour mark, and this new duping setup meant that the game was going to go way past that milestone in a very short amount of time. Sure enough, on November 16th, Omega gave us this run. This run had all the current dupes and a much cleaner endgame, resulting in the first sub-5 in San Andreas history.
15 microdots and announce it.
Also, run number 969, Will Smith, sub 5.
See you around.
Officer. Kiitos, Adam.
More dupes and setup for those dupes would be found in the coming weeks, including a method to dupe missions using Blood Bowl and Bite School instead of trucking, which saved a lot of travel time when duping inside the two big cities. This was an idea theorized by Patrick, with Zoton 2 doing most of the testing. Zoton discovered that you can simply hold your phone call button as you run out of time in Blood Bowl in order to get a call which you can use for duping. This removes the need to drive all the way out of San Fierro to the Badlands to start trucking, and the same applied for Bite School in Las Venturas. With this newfound knowledge and new dupes, it was clear that this run by Omega would not stand for very long. But would Omega continue his streak of dominance over the game? What if I told you that a new runner would come along and start his own streak, but this time for over 5 years and still counting to this day, therefore creating one of the most dominating streaks in GTA history? Allow me to introduce you to Reset.
Gold. Wow.
Reset started his streak of dominance in December of 2015, making use of new dupes, including duping Tebow Mendez to skip Mike Torino, Black Project to skip Green Goo, and duping Beatdown on B-Dub to skip Growth for Life. Later on, a dupe to skip Los Desperados was found in early 2016, and by May 31st, a holy grail was beginning to seem real. On May 31st, 2016, a user by the name of Mew25 posted a response to the seemingly useless glitches megathread on the speedrun.com forums. This post, however, was not useless at all, and was actually one of the holy grails of San Andreas speedrunning. This video showed a very particular setup to complete Los Desperados twice, which skipped all the way to the second part of End of the Line, the checkpoint just after killing Big Smoke. Because you skip the first checkpoint of this mission, you also skip the check of having to take over the required number of gang territories. Hence, gang territory skip was born. This was huge, and this allowed Reset to bring his time all the way down to a 4:37 by June 16th. This would stand as the record for a few months, as something even bigger was on the horizon. Remember a little while back when I mentioned the impossibility of skipping the entire Woozy chain and doing Las Venturas with 4 stars? Well, a neat little crossover between both the speedrunning and special vehicle collecting communities allowed for the creation of a strategy that might just make this possible. Allow me to explain. On June 13th, two members of the special vehicle community, named Rance and Orion SR, were discussing a method of modifying vehicles using the mechanic of taking a flight from one airport to the other. This didn't have anything to do with speedrunning, but they later realized that they didn't have a wanted level during this glitch, and reached out to Patrick to detail the glitch as they knew he had been keen to look for something similar. On July 16th, Patrick posted a video on the speedrun.com forums of doing the glitch and keeping the state of not being able to get a wanted level permanently. I'll quickly give you a rundown on how this glitch works. In San Andreas, you can take flights from the airport in the game in order to quickly travel from one city to another without having to fly for yourself. You simply pay a fee, watch a cutscene of the plane taking off and then landing at the other runway. During this travel time, you cannot obtain a wanted level, as the game sets your wanted level back to zero every single frame. You can use a glitch to gain control in this flight, get out of the plane, and then blow it up before it reaches its destination. and because the game still thinks you're on that flight that never finished, you continue in the game with permanent 0 stars. The only time your wanted level resets is when you die, get busted, or load a save. This glitch was the breakthrough Patrick needed in order to root Woozy Skip into San Andreas speedruns, skipping a huge amount of time in San Fierro. As a side effect to this though, the speedrun just became much more difficult, as during your entire time in Desert and Las Venturas, you cannot die or load a safety save. This meant that the skill ceiling had increased massively, but this didn't shy Reset away. On September 2nd, Reset achieved the first record with Woozy Skip, smashing his PB with a 4:31.18. Reset had several time losses that cost him a few minutes each in this run, so he set out to get as close to a perfect run as possible. A little over a month later, he gives us this. This run cleaned up all the potential time save that he had from his last PB, and made so few mistakes that even Reset mentioned in his comments section that he had no intention of improving this until somebody else stepped up and contested him. This record stood for about 8 months, and it was only because of a new desert mission route that Reset came back in order to drop the time even further. On June 24th, 2017, he got on this run with the new route. He still finished this run, but the big time loss at the end meant that the time could go even lower. With SA being so long and brutal, on top of the newest route making the room for error almost zero, it was going to be insanely hard to finish another run without mistakes like he had in the past. On September 17th, Reset achieved the 4:16 with a fail in Fender catch-up. Then a 4:15 with being trolled in Los Desperados. A 4:10 with a new route in Desert once again duping Hijack to skip Interdiction, which was rooted out a few months prior, but new developments allowed it to become faster again. And finally, a 4:07 on November 9th, 2017. This 4:07 would last for almost a year, as the run was getting more and more optimized and nobody was even close to Reset's skill level. This 4:07 also had a new dupe included, which was Explosive Situation Dupe to skip You've Had Your Chips. The issue with this dupe is that the vehicle you have to use for the mission spawns twice, and sometimes they will get stuck inside each other. If they do that, you fail the mission. This makes it a coin flip as to whether it will succeed, and made the inconsistency of this run become even worse. 2018 wasn't a completely dead year, however, as a new skip was in the works. The Jizzy mission in San Fierro is one of the longest missions in the game, as you need to basically do an entire loop around the city in a very slow car doing errands for Jizzy, and then finish it off with a chase at the end. Right before this mission is a cutscene, and it was known that duping the cutscene would likely skip the mission. However, when this cutscene is duped, one of the instances would get stuck, meaning that the strat wasn't possible. However, during some testing, it was discovered that triggering certain events would unstick these cutscenes. One of these methods is to date a girlfriend, and Katie was an available girlfriend in San Fierro. The plan was to develop a strat to date Katie in order to unstick this cutscene, and therefore skip the entire Jizzy mission. However, as my fellow gamers know, getting a girlfriend isn't that easy. Katie has a number of requirements before she will date CJ. These are all stats within the game, and include muscle, fat, and sex appeal. Fat and muscle aren't really a problem, but the route needed to be changed to allow for a certain level of sex appeal to be gained throughout the run, so Katie would find CJ attractive enough to want to date him. First of all, a sexy haircut was needed all the way back at the start of the game. The Jerry Curl is exactly the amount of money you start off with and gives you a small boost in sex appeal. The other thing that is needed is a nice car nearby, which gives you a massive boost. Instead of trying your luck with a sports car, it was later discovered that you can use a caddy from the nearby golf course to get the same effect, as long as you don't damage it. With Katie by our side, we could now take her on a 2-second date and immediately discard her for our benefit in the speedrun. Great job, gamers. On September 26th, Reset finished his first record with a new Jizzy Skip, and sent Tenpenny flying in 4 hours and 2 minutes.
Let's go.
Tried for 30 years to cross over. You managed it, man. I mean, man, you're an icon, man.
Oh, thanks, man.
I'm just glad it's finally over.
What's up? You know what's up with Smoke.
He always saw things cool. Different than us.
It had been known for a long time that Sub 4 was possible, but now it was starting to look like a real possibility, and all eyes were on Reset to provide. A little over a month later, on October 28th, we got this.
It's not a 359. Sorry to let you down, but it isn't.
This run was sub 4 pace going into the final city segment, but some unfortunate time losses and minor mistakes pushed it just over the edge. But this proved that Reset had the ability, and it was only a matter of time. No new strats were needed to make an easy milestone. This was all going to be on Reset and his insane amount of dedication and talent to push this game to the next level. A 4-year streak of dominance has got him to this point, and as we ticked into the new year, he began putting in more time and effort than anyone had ever seen. But this game was not gonna go down without a fight.
Oh, nice. That happened.
All right, that's the last.
Okay, rip run.
Hazer. We need to get him to a hospital.
I don't know what happened.
You don't want to get caught on the ballast trip while this shit's going
if
down.
They jump out, I'm just gonna stop them.
Hey, while we're here,
They're being fucking retards.
Whoa! Oh my god, what? This is so fucking stupid, man. What? Okay, this shit. Dude, this run is dead anyway. What the fuck? Hey girl. Dude! Whoa! Dude! Holy fuck. Holy shit. Dude. That scared the fuck out of me. Wow. A liquor store in Blueberry, a bank in Palomino Creek.
Well, not anymore. Jesus Christ.
Come on in, let's do this.
What? Oh my god. That's ridiculous. Wow. I haven't done that before. Just take this pussy armor or whatever. Just take the pussy armor.
Oh shit!
I'm stuck in a bala. Rip. How do you get out of this? You can't? Can you? Can you get out of this or no? Always the best run this week. I got a run to ESTUP yesterday, but it failed at ESTUP, so I guess that was the best one. No, no gold. Fuck. Ay, ay. That fucking van didn't explode for some reason for so long. But it was good anyway. It was a good winning saver. I'll take it.
Between Garcia and... This is the place. Whoa, Jesus, dude. Looks like you've been fed a bummer.
Whoa, Jesus, dude. Looks like you've been fed a bummer. It looks like you've been fed a bad Badlands. Yeah, truth, I know.
You think?
Don't miss the shot, please. Yes. Pro. I'm a pro. Don't start with this follower shit. Just keep it on 7 days. It worked. Okay. But the parachute part wasn't that great. We'll see. I think I opened it a bit too early. We'll see. No, it won't be a gold split. Is it really over?
This was it. San Andreas completed in under 4 hours. For a quick overview as to how much skill is needed to achieve this, this run is almost 2 years old, and yet only one other runner has achieved a sub 4 to this day. The amount of dedication and raw talent needed to take the game this low is why Reset deserves a title of being one of the best and most dominant GTA speedrunners to this day. He started his streak in 2015 and took the game all the way down an extra hour over those 4 years. However, this would not be Reset's final record, as yet another time save was about to be discovered. During the mission Outrider, you are tasked with escorting a van through a series of blockades until it reaches its final destination. The van does a lap of the city, and the mission finishes once the van reaches the nearby compound. This van is the important part of the mission, so if you could steal the van and get it to the compound early, you could skip several minutes worth of escorting it. However, the van is locked, so there is no way to access it, or so we thought. Two SA runners created a strategy that involved forcing the driver to exit the vehicle due to it being damaged, and then stealing the vehicle from there and driving it straight to the compound. With some adjustments from the community to make it quicker and easier, Outrider Skip was born. The reason this strategy works is because when a vehicle is damaged to the point of exploding, the driver will get out and try to run away when the vehicle's on fire. This would usually mean a mission fail, but you can immediately enter the nearby mission marker to trigger a fade, and in this game, a fade like this extinguishes fires. This means that the truck is essentially on 1 HP, and can be carefully driven to the end trigger. This saved a few minutes, and Reset knew that he had one more run left in him using this new strat. On April 23rd, Reset finished the first record with Outrider Skip, and his final entry into the record books.
I think, right? Yeah. Good. You love to see it. Please, cop bike. $3.52. What? Oh my god. That's a great run. Holy shit. That's a great run, boys. That's a great run. That's a great run. And everything went well too, like all the RNG bits, like intensive care, Sultan for homecoming, then I got a Sultan after cutthroat business. The homies didn't jump out. Yo. The taxi even went west and he didn't stop for lights. Holy shit. That's a great run.
This record still technically stands to this day, as a new and final discovery would absolutely destroy SA speedrunning and completely redefine what we know of San Andreas Any Percent. Hey, anyone remember this guy?
One elephant.
Yes! Yes! Let's fucking go! The elephants! For the elephants! FAQ split! Yes! Fuck your fucking shitty setup, PowerNet. I'll just make my own one up. Fuck that. Alright. World record! Yes! It only took 2 days. The perfect fucking outcome. End of the line 3. Not end of the line 1. Not end of the line 2. Not Riot. Part fucking 3. Straight to the end, my man. Yes! Only took me an hour fucking up, but I did it. After 7 or 6 or some amount of years, I finally have Any Percent world record again. And the time is... 1:32:08. G to the fucking G. I did it. Yes. Yes. I did it, Emma.
Joshimus had just completed San Andreas start to finish in 90 minutes, using a new glitch found by PowderNet that basically allows you to skip from the second mission of the game all the way to the final mission of the game. I'm not even going to bother and try and explain such madness, but if any of you nerds out there would like a technical explanation, I'll link one in the description. The issue is that this only works on the remastered, quote-unquote, version of the game, which is actually a disgusting mobile port that Rockstar placed on the Windows Store as a complete slap in the face to fans all around the world, out of pure greed. This version is frankly horrible to play, so most runners stick to the new category, where Reset was still on top, known as Any% NoAGS. However, over the next few months, the Any% record was traded a bunch and was eventually optimized all the way down to 15 minutes by a series of runners, namely Josh, Hoxie, Powdernet, the Gary, 123 Robot.
Yes! 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 Let's go! Let's go! Let's go! Let's go! Let's go! Oh no!
And real Kevin. Kevin's time of 14:57 is where the San Andreas Any% record stands today, as he joins Reset on top of their respective leaderboards. So, that's the story of how San Andreas speedruns went from 8 hours of VHS tapes footage back in 2005, all the way to a 15-minute speedrun on a mobile port 15 years later, and a history of all the strats and people that led us to this point. I'd like to give a special thanks to everyone who helped me create this timeline and ensure its accuracy. I couldn't have done it without you. I hope you enjoyed the video. I've also made a similar video about Vice City speedrunning, which I will leave in the description, along with some resources if you wish to learn more about the world of Grand Theft Auto speedrunning. Thank you very much for joining me on this journey, and I hope you have a wonderful day.
Well, I'm done for now. I'm actually gonna go lie in a bed and not a chair. So, that's it, boys.